Welcome.
Thank you.
You know, you've been such an influence for so many guitar players. I was wondering who was your influence when you were coming up.
I thought you'd answer that question. In fact, my early influences were mainly American. Mm-hmm. The early rock and roll guitarists, people like Scotty Moore. And of course, Scotty played on those early Elvis records. I think for me, the greatest period for Elvis Presley. And Cliff Gallup on the Gene Vincent records from, say, 56, 57. Mm-hmm. The classics like Bebopalula, Race with the Devil. Buddy Holly and James Burton was a sensation. Now, those sounds for us in the UK at that time were absolutely fantastic. We never heard anything like it. The guitars have this twang, but also the way the guys played, you know, the kind of notes they used and the style in which they played. We never heard anything like it. Most guitarists in Britain in those days would be professional guitarists would be people who had come out of a dance band situation with a very mellow, sweet sound, and therefore their approach to music would be, that's where they're coming from.
Yeah, right.
And this was something totally different. It was like coming from Mars, but it was absolutely fantastic. And as soon as I heard that, I wanted to play like it. Mm. Never quite achieved it, but wanted to play like it.
So maybe you could show us what you got from each one of those particular guitar players. Like, let's start with Scotty Moore.
One thing that I remembered very well, Scotty, was a lot of the tape echo that was used on the early Presley records. And there's like a thing, Mystery Train, which is something like the riff he plays. And there's this riff going all the way through, this train effect, which is fantastic. And then he does a great solo in there as well, which I think, again, he's pick and fingers, yeah, as against finger and picks. And that's pretty cool too, with that tape echo on.
So that riff you played, you had a pretty much an alternating bass line that you did with your pick, like over an E chord.
Yes, it's something like. I'm trying to do it slowly.
So what you're doing is you're alternating the bass line on each downbeat,
yeah,
and then adding the treble notes on the syncopated part of the beat.
Yes. Yeah, you say that very well. That's right, that's what's happening. And of course, what helps it is the slap echo, that.
Oh, yeah.
It gives it that movement that is not really quite there without it. Mm.
So did you get your idea for your echo sound through Scotty Moore's sound, or?
Well, not entirely. One aim I had in the early days was to try to sound like that, but it was impossible without tape echo, and I don't even know that Scotty sounded like that on stage because it was a studio effect. But I was fortunate in 1959 in coming across one of the early echo boxes. In fact, I believe it was the first, made by an Italian firm called Miazzi. It was actually made under license or certainly sold in Britain as a Vox echo. It was a fantastic thing to plug a guitar in and get that sort of echo. But it didn't stop there. It had multi-heads. It had five heads. So you could have a series of echoes, not just this short slap echo. Mm-hmm. The heads were spaced fairly evenly, but depending on which combination of heads you had, you could get a different combination of gaps in between the echoes. So it made a sort of tripping echo effect. And I tended to favor that because this is great for rock and roll, but if you're playing something a little bit different, something more moody, maybe something more melodic, that was a very interesting echo, and I use that kind of thing still today.
When was it that you decided that the echo was going to be such an integral part of your sound? How did that evolve?
As soon as I heard it, to me, the guitar dry on stage was just not happening. At least on record, you could get maybe a bit of tape echo and reverb. And on stage, it was all, just to me, the missing link, you know? And when I first heard that Miazzi Echo Box, to me, it was this was the answer, particularly because of this multi-tap thing when you could get the most interesting effects. Mm. So immediately, I started to experiment with it, and within like a week, I was convinced that there's no other way to go. And everyone who heard it when I was playing it was just amazed, because they hadn't heard them either. You know, it was a brand new thing in the country.
Let's check out an echo sound, if you will.
Yeah. I mean, let's say, for example, Apache, which was the first hit, the Shadows.
Shadows, right. Yeah.
And that was quite an echoey record. And that, again, had this interesting multi-tapped echo on.
Okay, so you were going to show us your Apache.
Yeah, now just to indicate the difference in the echo, say, between this and the slap, if I just hit a damp note, you can hear the echo. Let's see.
So this has a definite rhythm to it.
Yeah, yeah. So, and it gives a nice ambience to the note. Say on the galvan. It's not exactly in time with the music as such, but it just seems to work somehow. But that's the kind of echo that the Miazzi had with this multi-head. And of course you can change the speed to make that a faster or slower effect.
So this particular sound was, I guess, written to duplicate a Miazzi echo.
Yes, a fan in the UK has spent around 3 years writing software for a Quadriverb 2. He's sampled all the old records and a lot of my new stuff, and he sampled the echoes and worked out the gaps in the heads, and he's set up the echo. He's even put little things in like subtle changes of EQ on each head, which was a natural byproduct of the early echo boxes because of the way they were designed. And he's done a terrific job, and of course now it means everything is set up MIDI. You can change from one to the other on stage. Either my technician does it for me or through a pedal board, without having to turn manually to an echo box, changing speed, changing echo type or whatever. It's all preset, and it's a terrific arrangement.
Let's listen to another one, shall we?
Okay, let's do that. Okay. I think another probably quite obvious echo is the one I use on Wonderful Land. Mm-hmm. Now, on Wonderful Land, the echo is quite different from Apache, and I'll again play a muted section so you can hear the echo. And that gives this tripping, shimmering effect, which I rather like.
Yeah, it's pretty neat.
Yeah.
What chord is that played over?
I don't know.
It looks like a C, E minor to F to G, right?
Then the last bit.
It's good. Let me try that, playing that with you, okay?
Do you want to do the slow or
slow.
Normal speed?
Let's go slowly.
Two,
first.
Three, four, one. It's a pretty tune.
You know, you also have a great echo sound on another Shadows tune, Atlantis. I was wondering if you could show that.
Yeah,
for
that's fairly similar to this one, but it's similar in that it's a very fast, shimmering echo, but not quite. So the Atlantis intro is three, one, two.
I was wondering if you could play the melody to Atlantis over the chords, okay?
Absolutely.
Go over the chords here. I guess the first chord is an F, right?
Yes.
And then we go to C.
Mm-hmm.
B flat. F. And C. And then A minor, right? A minor, B flat, G minor, back
beautiful.
To C. Yeah. So
beautiful.
Maybe you could play the melody.
There's no end to your talent.
Yeah. You just fed me all the chords during the break.
Okay.
All right.
Well, just the tune?
Yeah, just play the tune and just
two,
the melody.
Three, four.
Mm-hmm. I was wondering how you might use your echo effects over a more rockier tune, over something like, say, you know, The Rise and Fall of Flingle Bunt. And I can't believe I got that title out.
Right, well, on that one, I used it mainly to emphasize the riff that starts and ends the piece. And I use it mainly on this number as a kind of almost a rhythmic effect.
And it's on Flingle, right?
The intro is a sort of damped thing played in fifth. So you get a... And I like that effect. That's why I used it that way. It doesn't really have too much of an effect in the actual the tune. It's there, but obviously that rhythmic effect is lost because of the legato notes.
Right.
But it's particularly effective in that.
Yeah, on the power chord, it sounds great. Yeah. Another cool facet of your style is your liberal use of double stops. And the cool thing is, I think, is that you not only use the typical minor pentatonic double stops that I'm sure guys like, you know, Cliff Gallup use, but you also use major double stops too, built on the major scale.
Yes.
So I was wondering if you could like run, I don't know, some patterns based on the major scale and then some patterns based on the minor pentatonic.
Let's take something like a record called Living Doll, which we did with Cliff in 1959. And
that would be Cliff Richard.
Cliff Richard, right. And that was a huge hit for Cliff around the world. And a simple little song and done in a very sort of gentle country way. And I just felt that a double stop solo would be good in that. So that's really a major thing.
Mm-hmm. Now, double stops, I guess, are... basically two notes played at the
two
same time.
Two notes together, yeah. So you've got, let's say...
Okay, now, so what you're doing is you're harmonizing, that's a D, right?
That was a D scale.
A D major scale in thirds, pretty much. So maybe you could play that a little slower. You're playing it on the top two strings.
Well, yes.
Yeah, okay.
So you've got your...
So you got the D on the root on the second string and the third on the E string, right? And then, based on that scale, you come up with all sorts of...
Well, yeah, in this case, the Living Doll was in the key of A.
Okay.
And the solo was... just remember this. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So basically, you're just playing thirds based on the A major scale.
Yeah.
Just moving.
Yeah, although I did slip in a ninth and a seventh.
Oh, you did. But I see.
I thought it sounded cool at the time. No, I'm not too sure.
So maybe we could do the solo to Living Doll, and I'll try to accompany you.
Great. I'll give you a little count in, okay? Just give me a sprung. A one, two, three, four.
You know, another favorite tune of mine that the Shadows used to do, where you used really cool double stop ideas, was Kon-Tiki.
Oh, right.
So maybe you could show us
that
what
would,
you played.
That would be in the solo.
Right,
the variation. I begin actually by playing the open first string and droning it through the first few notes. So we start off with the open first, an E, and an E on the second string. Then I slide up to the A on the second string, but still droning the, then to the B with the drone, then hit the double stopping.
Adding that beautiful
gets me out of a lot of trouble, believe me.
All right, well, let's try playing it. All right.
Okay. One, two, three, four, one.
You know, another really cool major double stop idea you used was on Shindig. Mm. And there you did the double stops in conjunction with hammer-ons too, which I thought was kind of neat.
Yeah, well, I was trying to get a sort of a like country fourth thing into there. As my country fourth period. And yeah, it sort of goes.
So you're basically, like, let's grab the first hand.
Yeah.
You're playing the E and the A, and then you're hammering on the F sharp from the E. Is that correct?
Okay. Right. So it's against the D chord. Then when I hit the G, I actually go from basically G, put the six in. Again, moving up to the G up here. But the same principle as this one. Again.
So you're hammering those on again in conjunction with the vibrato arm.
Yeah.
The
same thing. Making it sing as again. Get one. Oh, you got one.
Oh, yeah. I never use it, though. All right, let's try playing it, okay?
Yeah.
Great.
Okay. One, two, a one, two, three, four.
We can go to the minor double stops. I noticed that with the Shadows, you did a lot of major double stop work. Yeah. And with Cliff Richard, you seem to be playing more rockier stuff, kind of more minor pentatonic double stops along the lines of Cliff Gallup. I was wondering if that was an influence.
Oh, definitely. Yeah. Also, of course, you work to the material. The numbers we've just played called out for major double stopping, really. Whereas with some of Cliff's material, the more rocky stuff was like 12 bars or whatever. Again, it cries out for that minor pentatonic. Mm-hmm. It sounds right for the music. So I think you've got to do what is right for the music that you're given. And in those cases, it seemed appropriate, even without thinking about it, that's what you play. It's all minor pentatonic stuff.
Yeah. Maybe you could show us like a position or two that you base your minor pentatonic double stops ideas out of?
Yeah. Say something like, do you want to dance? Mm-hmm. So I'm starting off, this is in G, by the way, the key in G. I'm starting off with first and second strings. It's really the ninth and the sixth, then a sharp nine, seven.
One of my favorite minor pentatonic double stop solos of yours is on Cliff Richard's Nine Times Out of Ten. I think it's just really rocking.
It's one of my favorites, too.
Oh, well, there you go. I was wondering if you might be able to recall it or some of it and play for it.
Yeah, I had a bit of a listen the other day to that, funnily enough, and may not be exactly the same, but similar. Mm-hmm. And it's sort of, I don't know if I can play it slowly, first of all. Would that help?
Sure, that'd be great, yeah.
So it starts with it. Basically the thing. I mess it up in the middle, but that's more or less how it goes, the shapes. So it's all minor pentatonic, really.
Yeah. I'm going to try to accompany you on that one, too, and maybe we can get an idea
thought you might.
What they sound like, what these lines sound like over real chords.
A one, two, three, four, one.
You know, I've seen all these things you've played so far. You've used the vibrato bar pretty extensively.
Yes.
And other than the echo, I think that's another very signature trademark of your sound. And I was hoping you could go over your approach to the vibrato bar
okay.
for us.
Yeah. Perhaps the story behind this is interesting. Mm-hmm. The first Strat I got in 59 was, as all Fender guitars, strung with very, very heavy strings, something like a 13 to a 56 or a 26 round third. And that's all we knew in those days, very heavy strings. And I never liked the sound of a guitar that just, if you're playing a tune, just went. Yeah. I wanted to hear, like on a classical guitar, you know, you'll get a bit of a finger beat going there. But with the heavy strings, it was difficult to achieve that. Right. And when I first got hold of this thing and realized what it could do, the first thing that interested me was trying to produce some kind of a, almost like a vocal effect. So you'd get a note going. A little bit of human vibrato on. And I just felt it kind of made the guitar live a little bit. Mm-hmm. Now that works on slow things, obviously, but you can also use it on faster things to give it this human effect, or take it a stage beyond that where you might do something where you're really going.
Wow. Yeah.
Or you know,
for
or
effect.
The. Little things like that which are not possible without the
sure.
arm. And I tried to incorporate, as I was learning how to use it and finding out what it could achieve, all those different effects. And it became an integral part of my playing. And I just felt, you know, it's like with words and an actor with words. You can say the words in a monotone fashion, and they're still great words, but they can lose their meaning unless there's expression put in. And to me, it's the same with an instrument. You can play the notes, and it can sound, well, they're great notes, a great tune, but
right.
where's the expression? Where's the interpretation? And I felt this helped me to be able to do something better than I could without it. Mm-hmm. So I was very happy that I had a Strat with this on. It was also great for using heavy strings, as it was in those days, very difficult to bend anything. Mm. And I had it set up, as I have to a degree now, where you can actually pull a note up, you know.
Wow.
So I used to give myself a bit of help by
sure.
pulling it up.
Sure.
And if you couldn't think of anything else to play, you could always go and give a real waggle, and anyone went, yeah, fantastic. So a wonderful thing. And I love the sound of the tremolo arm. It's quite different to a finger vibrato, which
sure.
a blues player or whatever you use. I use that playing acoustic guitars. Mm. But on this, I just like the kind of things you can get, even on chords, you know, if you do
right.
And, you know, any of those, it's just got a nice, got a lovely sound.
Yeah. And I also noticed that when you play single notes, sometimes you swoop into a note,
yeah.
or sometimes you play a note and then you just slightly drop it. So that's just basically a matter of taste of what you hear. I guess you try to emulate a singer or a voice.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So you
just as an example on Peggy Sue, I instead of hitting there, I go. Just a little.
Okay, so let's see exactly what you're doing. Right before you're hitting the note, you swoop it down with, you're holding it with the.
In the palm of my hand, basically, and with those fingers around it.
Uh-huh.
The three fingers that aren't
okay.
holding the pick.
Right.
It gives them something to do. Yeah. Keeps them honest.
Right.
So yeah, so just before I hit the note, I dip the tremolo arm. So it's
flatter,
rising to the note.
Yeah.
Then the next I go, and I bend that one down after hit it, and then bend up to this one. And then just put the vibrato on there. And then just give a little, in the way that a singer probably would.
Yeah. My Peggy Sue. See, that last bit is really cool because it almost sounds like you're bending the notes bending a note on an adjacent string, and you're playing basically the same note. You're just dipping with the
That's
bar, right?
Right?
Yeah. Could you show that again?
Yeah. The whole thing, or just that?
Just that part. Just a little slower, please. Really lyrical.
Thank you.
Yeah. Let's play the whole thing again and
okay, so do it slowly. So okay. We start off with rising to the note. Okay. So I'm pushing the trello arm down before I hit the note. So I pull that one down, then rising again. There's another technique that seemed to work very well on this, where I wanted to get more bite from the lower string, so I played nearer the bridge. And in order to use the tremolo arm, use it with my left hand. So you get on the I suppose you'd call it the chorus, perhaps. Then back to normal. So it's just dipping the string to...
You're just playing the open A string, right?
Yeah.
That's all it is, huh?
Yeah, just so bending it. And then...
That's like a heavy metal move, you know? Kind of
yeah. Crossing. It's the only way I could do it, really, and it seems to work very well. Mm-hmm. So that's one technique which is quite handy. I use that also in another thing we do on stage, an old jazz thing called the Savage, mm-hmm. where I do a little bit of
That's
the idea,
savage,
but it's quite handy to get.
You know, show us that lick, because that's a real cool lick with the open string pull-offs and the whole bit on the Savage.
Oh, right, yeah, it starts off again on the open A string.
Right.
That'll do.
Wow, so you're pulling off from this to the A, to D, E flat to E.
Yeah.
That's really cool.
That's the sort of thing. And it works well when the band's playing.
It works well now too.
Yeah. But it's quite effective. So you can do it any open string.
Yeah.
But it is handy for something like that when it would be difficult to actually do and use that here. You know, right. you need the free right hand.
Yeah.
And so that gives the facility to free up the hand to do a tremolo kind of thing.
Yeah, now, in Peggy Sue, you combine that technique with what I think is the lick of the song. You played that open whammy bar thing, and then you played some ascending run in like F major pentatonic.
Yeah,
it's so cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's it. That's it. Maybe you could just slow those notes down, because it's
over an F pentatonic, really.
Uh-huh. Well, that's a big stretch. So you're going C and then A on the.
It starts off on F.
Okay.
F to G. So if you imagine the bar chord.
Back.
Then up to the A. To the C, then jump up to the A,
So the last two notes have that big interval, that sixth interval there. It's very cool. Here's a great case where a great instance, I should say, where the echo adds so much.
Oh, absolutely.
Because it just shimmers, that run just, it sounds amazing,
I think I actually damped it on the record, but I rather prefer it open, in fact.
Yeah, you did damp it on the record.
Yeah, when I look back, I wish I'd played it open, so now I do play it open.
Yeah, it's cool. Now, you also play the melody using, I don't know whether it's double stops or chords or triads, but it sounds so great.
Which, is that the...
Yeah. That's great. Please slow it down. I mean, it's so melodic, it just stands like a solo unto itself. I know it's just your interpretation of a melody,
okay.
but the treatment is amazing.
It starts off
on the fifth fret here using a second string on the E, mm-hmm. third on the B. So it's as if it's come off an E chord, right. which it is, in fact,
yeah.
up into the A. So I just slide up to the position here to hit the this chord. Still on the second and third, then I go to the second and first, and I dip the string there. Then back down to the, when I'm in a C chord,
okay. second or third. It's a D chord.
What did I say?
C.
Sorry, D, yeah.
yeah, yeah.
Just testing. Then back up to the A here, second mm-hmm. and third. Then a hammer on there.
Oh, yeah.
So we go from the second and third. To the first and second, again still on the A chord. Mm-hmm. Then I hammer on here.
Oh, yeah.
So hammer on, then off. And then that's the second and third.
Okay, let me just stop you there because I've noticed that you're using a hybrid picking. You're using pick and fingers too to play those double stops rather than just using your pick. Maybe you could just show us how you do that.
Yeah. Sometimes I use the pick, and other times I feel more comfortable with my fingers. It gives mm-hmm. a bit more control sometimes. Right.
I notice that, especially when you're doing the hammer-ons, you're using the...
From which bit in particular, any...
Oh, yeah, I noticed you're doing it on the
hammer, I think.
On the... Right. And also on the hammering the sixth over the G chord.
So it's... Hammer.
Now it's my error. I said G chord. It's the A chord.
A. Right. On the A chord, then back down, hammer on, but that goes to the D chord.
Oh, that's neat. So and then you shift your first finger over to...
Up to the, which is on the D.
Right.
First and second. Then I slide up to the D, the D. Then I come across, and I suspend the B, so the other notes are descending.
So you're holding the B while you're playing the moving line underneath
it.
Yeah.
I actually use that with a pick. I could use my finger as well, but in this case, I... So that's how that's done.
Can we play it up to speed?
Okay,
sure.
1, 2, 3.
That's great.
Thank you. Yeah. I enjoy that too. It's a nice feel, those double stops. It sings nicely. Yeah. You know,
I think the best way to show your abilities with the tremolo arm is maybe just to play a tune. You do a tune in your live shows that I think is like one of the most beautiful tunes ever written. It's a tune called Sleepwalk, and you just play the you know what out of that vibrato arm. So.
Let's do it then.
Okay.
3, 4. Thank you.
So, along with the whammy bar and the echo and the double stops, another really interesting facet of your style is the fact that you you use palm muting a lot to play your lines, and use it in a real interesting way. And I was wondering if you could show us how you do it.
Yeah, well, the technique is fairly simple. It's putting the heel of the hand on the bridge where the, so you're just covering the string. So instead of the string, say, for example, going, in here I'd stopped, and then if I keep my hand there, so the string will not ring. It's just the short attack, really, in a very quick decay. I do little bits of it in numbers, depending, of course, on the tune. But one tune we did write years ago, which was from a film called Summer Holiday, was a big hit for the Shadows, thing called Foot Tapper. And most of that is, in fact, a damped technique.
Before we play Foot Tapper, I'd like to ask you more specifically exactly where it is you place your hand on the bridge. Maybe you could show us.
Yeah, okay. Well, the very rear part of the hand is on the bridge, but of course if it's too far back, then the string is not muted, thus. Right. Now if I move it slightly forward, so you've just got to really feel it. Now, I guess it's experience, you know, once you get used to it, you just feel exactly where to drop your hand on the bridge. So it's really this section here, which is muting the string, this is resting on the bridge. And it's the fleshy part there, which is on the string.
So as you're playing, your hand is constantly resting on the bridge, or are you moving?
No, I leave it on the bridge.
That's of course the tune you mentioned, Foot Tapper.
That's the intro to Foot Tapper.
Yeah.
So that's the technique, basically.
Okay, could you just slow it down a little bit and just see how you...
Yeah.
So on that intro to Foot Tapper, you're actually playing over each chord. You're kind of like not arpeggiating or hitting the notes of each chord. Is that correct?
So it starts off on C. Then I lead down to the A for the A minor. Down to the F for the F chord. Then it hits the G of the G chord. So it leads into each chord quite obviously. It's a fairly obvious sort of... Yeah. Pattern, really.
And the whole...
I wish I thought of something more sophisticated.
So the whole thing is played using your muting technique.
That's right. And then the tune that follows.
Okay, could you...
Back into the intro.
So what do you say we give it a go?
We'll give it a go.
All right.
1, 2, 3, 4.
You know what? That bridge is really cool there too. Could you show us the bridge while you're at it?
The double stopping, yeah.
Yeah,
it's,
sure.
It's over the G again. That major pentatonic. I'll separate the notes so we get.
Okay. Yeah. Nice.
Thank you.
You know,
it can be yours for a small fee.
I got the video. One of my favorite riffs is the intro to FBI.
All right.
I'm trying to figure it out, and I'm kind of stuck. Could you show it to me?
Yeah. Well, one of my colleagues in the Shads played that, Bruce Welsh.
Oh, really?
It's basically played over the bar chord, but using the thumb. On the sixth string, so you're getting.
So that's how you alternate the bass by looking
right.
At some. I see. That's how you get that.
He's got bigger hands than me.
Okay, that's how you got that bounce going over that string. But you're muting that also as well on the low string,
yes,
right?
Yes, that's right. It's only it's basically the two the fifth and sixth that are being muted. And every now and again, slipping in, mm-hmm. I think more by actual by inaccurate picking mm-hmm. than by design to get in the. Added quite a nice flavor to it, really.
It's great.
Because no one could work out if it was supposed to be actually in a minor key or a major key, but that major third gives it away.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a major, but the melody has actually got the minor third in, again on the minor pentatonic against the chord.
It's a great blues sound, having the minor third
it
against
is.
The major third, yeah.
Particularly when you play them both at the same time.
Right. Well, then you're playing jazz, right? Another really great muting passage and a particular favorite of mine is what you play on Atlantis. And I was wondering if you'd show that.
That's on the introduction,
yes.
and it occurs, a little motif. Well, I play it on the first, second, and third strings. Mm-hmm. And it's, the phrase is. That's the phrase, basically.
Okay. Now, again, you're muting throughout the whole passage, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So all three strings are muted. I don't really have to move my palm. Mm-hmm. It's in position. And again, it's the alternate picking.
Right. I was going to ask you what the picking pattern was on that. Okay. Maybe you could just play just a tad slower so that people can pick it up quicker. I'm going to try to accompany you on this intro again.
Fine.
Let's see what it sounds like with some chords behind it.
Okay. One, two.
You know, there are so many Shadows fans out there still to this day, even new generation, young generations of Shadows fans. I think it'd be really kind of cool if you maybe, like, showed a few of the tunes, just the melodies and the bridges and stuff.
Yeah.
I was thinking maybe you could start with Apache, play it down, give us some of the more interesting features, and then take
whatever,
it. Okay.
Whatever, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, first of all, I play the main melody down on the second fret here. I just like the sound of the strings there. In fact, this guitar's strung a little lighter than I would normally use for Apache, but I'll play in the position. So I usually play with my first finger there on this. And I waggle the tremolo arm, you see, to take your mind off the music.
Now, the chords underneath that would be, I guess, A minor to D, right? Okay, so let's see what that sounds like.
What, is this slow?
Yeah, this slow, yeah, sure.
2, 3. And then the other bit, where I damp the strings to do the galloping bit on the little choruses. So that's damping across here and just, but slowly.
So just playing them on the A and on the D strings, right?
Yeah, just on the two strings over the chord of F.
F, right.
Yeah.
And by muting, all the specific notes being regenerated by the echo come out.
Clear. That's right. It really emphasizes the echo, and it gives a bit of attack, I think, at that point.
Hank, I'm sure a lot of people would really like to know how you play the melody to Man of Mystery, one of the Shadows' biggest hits.
It was written originally for a TV series in Britain. It was a thriller series, and it was done very slowly. And we kind of sped it up a little bit in our version, but the tune's almost like an arpeggiation over the chord sequence. A minor, E7th, A7th, D, D major, D major, D minor, back to A minor. So it's, I play it down here, all in the low position. I like the sound of the strings there. And it goes across, starts on the third string. Same tune again.
Yeah.
It's a great tune.
It's great. And two things I've noticed. One is that you're consistently using the whammy bar.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, I don't think you take your hand off it throughout the whole melody, right? You use it to dip on every note, pretty much?
Or? No, I do, yeah. Mm-hmm. It's a kind of safety thing, really. Yeah. I might fall off unless I hold on to this thing.
Yeah.
But it gives a bit of, I think, tension to the...
I also noticed that you're using the open E string a lot in your arpeggiations.
Yeah.
That's kind of cool, too.
It's such a great sound, that open E string. It's got a lot of vibrancy, these high strings. You know, the zing, which you don't always get on these strings. They can sound a little dead in comparison. I think it's important if you're playing instrumentals to work out, when you're playing the tune, where it sounds best, where you get the most life out of the guitar. It may be easier to play it in one position, but it may sound a bit dull, a bit dead. Mm-hmm. And who wants to be dull and dead? Not me, not for quids.
All right, let's try. Let's try playing it.
Probably about the tempo of the record. Eh?
Okay, sure.
Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4.
I can't tell you what an honor and a pleasure it's been to get to know you and to work with you on this video. Your style is just amazing, and I've learned so much from it, and I'm sure everyone out there has learned from it as well. And just want to thank you. Thank you very much.
It's been a real pleasure.
Yeah.